Hello and welcome to your online lecture of weathering and erosion. So we're going to learn a little bit about the differences between weathering and erosion and how those words really begin the carving and structure of our landscape. So the photo that I have picked here was one that I took on my cell phone. It's one of my favorite photos. It's called the Mobius Arch. It's an iconic feature there in the Eastern Sierra. The rock in the foreground is was identified as a monzonite granite, which means that it's pea-size grain, crystalline structure, which means it cools slowly, but not too slowly. The rock in the background, that's the Sierra Nevada, a very different type of granite. That's the Yosemite granite. Some of their crystalline size is over a foot in diameter. And so, you know, that being said, which one cooled the slowest? That would be the Sierra granite. Looking here, that's Mount Whitney. That's our tallest peak in the lower 48 states at over 14,508 feet in elevation. So what's interesting about the idea of weathering and erosion is that this is the process that allows us to begin to break down material and create a new landscape. So what's very interesting about this, very similar to that of Joshua Tree, is this very bulbous erosion that we're seeing that's being caused by that weathering. And we'll talk a little bit about that because it's actually quite unique. So let's begin. Well, what is weathering? Weathering is the physical or chemical alteration of primary minerals that make up parent material. Well, what is a parent material? Well, that granite we saw in the earlier photo, that is parent material. It is the solid rock material in which all things derive from in that sense of looking at soils, right? You need to have some solid rock first that then erodes and turns into, sediments that can then be lithified and turn into a new style of rock. So this is the actual breaking of those materials. Now I use the phrase no motion, meaning that when we're looking at weathering, it's just the process. When we bring in the value of motion, that's when dealing more with erosion. Erosion is that motion. Now there are two families of weathering. There's physical or mechanical, and the other one is chemical. So physical or mechanical means there's no change in the lithology or the actual construction of that material. So a great example of physical weathering would be if you throw a candy bar in your mouth and you start chomping down on the candy bar, your teeth are breaking the candy bar into smaller pieces. So if you were to then regurgitate what you just chewed up a little bit with just your teeth, people would know it was still a Snickers bar. It would be gross, but they'd know it's a Snickers bar because you haven't changed any of the composition of the elements or the minerals that were within that mass. Now, chemical on the other side would be if you swallowed the candy bar and the acids in your stomach began breaking it down and turning it back into its smallest elements, and then you regurgitated it, no one would know what it was because it would just be a disgusting mess. Well, that's because the chemicals, the acids in your stomach dissolved that candy bar and broke it down even further. So let's go back to physical or mechanical. So there's no change in the lithology, no change in the chemical composition. Types that we see would be like exfoliation, frost wedging, thermal expansion, the process of material becoming wet and dry and wet and dry. We'll speak more to some of these in a moment, but these are the examples of physical or mechanical. So think of just literally when the environment has the ability to break things apart. Then moving into chemical, that's when you actually change the composition. So there's a couple different types. When water is used, such as hydrolysis, that's when you're using a solution to break down material and change it. Oxygen can be used in the process of oxidation, or the use of carbon dioxide or carbonation, or lastly, just acids. When you actually just pour an acid onto something and watch it dissolve, it changes its composition. So a great example of chemical weathering would be when you're looking at photos of the gargoyles or the headstones in Italy, and by today's standard, they all look like they've melted, like they've dissolved a little bit. Well, that's exactly what's happened, is because of acid rain, they've been able to dissolve the composition of that marble. Marble is usually some form of carbonate made out of like a limestone that's been metamorphosed, so which means that it does have the ability to dissolve using very weak acid. Now down here there's an asterisk, there's bioturbation. I throw that in there just because sometimes it comes up in conversation, about plants and animals. Do they have the ability to break rocks apart and break material apart? And the answer is, well, They do. It's a little bit different than this natural process that there is no alteration or change what we do. It's kind of the process. But plants and animals do have that ability, and we'll see an example of that later. So let's move forward. So let's look at an example of exfoliation. So perhaps you've seen a photo like this before on the left. And this is Half Dome. In fact, these little itty-bitty dots right here, these are people that are walking up to the top of Half Dome. What's interesting about Half Dome is it may at first look like an onion. You can see these very distinct sheets or slabs of rock that look just like the layers of an onion. Well, let's talk about why this occurs. So this is a very simplistic time lapse, going, you know, when it's orogeny, then it began to be exposed, and then through full exfoliation. So when the granitic pluton was then cooling and becoming, so it went from a molten material to a rock, as it solidified, it stored all this pressure from all the material around it, and something that's not viewed here, the atmosphere above it. So it stored all of that stress and tension and pressure. Well, now we can see that over, you know, a series of erosion, we've eroded this upper part of material away, now exposing some of this pluton. Well, what happens? Well, we see that the pressure is able to release. So since that rock was so compressed and tight, kind of like, imagine like a dog pile, you know, that phrase where someone jumps down, everyone jumps on top of them. Being that person on the bottom, you're storing all that stress and all that tension. Well, once everyone starts getting off, you're able to stretch out and actually expand. And in that process, it fractures along these weaknesses within the rock, creating these joints. So then what we do is we create this very large bulbous or rounded feature. Well, what about Half Dome? It's only half a dome. That's a good point. Glaciation took part of that away, so that's a different process. A glacier has not been involved in the Yosemite Valley. It would not look the same way as it does. A great example, of these bulbous things, perhaps you've been to Joshua Tree, it's that same process. And if you go look at that type of granite, you can actually see the layers. So maybe you've also heard of Yosemite's really large rock falls they get all the time. Well, those rock falls occur because these large slabs of rock, they joint and they pop off because that pressure is able to release, and large sheets of granite fall off. How big? Several football stadium sizes in just sheer distance and width. So very large amounts of rock. Moving forward, we can look at frost wedging. This is another example of that. I used my watch for scale. This at one point was one rock. Water gets in there. Then the water freezes, and as water freezes, it expands, resulting in actually wedging or tearing the rock apart. So this now, what was once one rock, is now broken into four smaller rocks. To make things a little complicated, it's kind of hard to see, but you can see some discoloration down here. We can also see that there's probably some chemical weathering in there as well, but the major process that we see here is actually frost wedging. So here's an example of chemical. Here's oxidation. This is a photo I took of Red Rock Canyon in Cantil, California. So here we have beautiful stratigraphy that's been exposed and very rich layers of the grays, the whites, and the reds. So oxidation is the process of atmospheric oxygen reacting with the rock to produce an oxide known as rusting. So there was already a metal that was deposited within that material. This red material is actually different mixtures of basalt from volcanic flows. So then what ends up happening in this result is that because of oxygen and water, it begins to rust. What's also interesting about this picture in particular is that you see there's no oxidation occurring in these whiter areas. That's actually volcanic ash. So we can see there's multiple layers of ash, and then we can see that there's basalt and ash and basalt, so on and so forth. What's interesting about that is, one, that they are able to take samples of this ash to see where the volcanics come from. Most of the volcanics here are local in California. But there are deposits from Yellowstone National Park all the way in California that is observed in this landscape here. Another thing that we can look at is maybe observing that, well, there's some layers that stick out farther than others. Well, the rocks that stick out further are more resistant to weathering. The ones that are, you know, being kind of pulled in a sense, are more susceptible to erosion, meaning that the material through weathering is able to transfer away. So if you think about it, you know, the differences between hard rock and powdered volcanic ash, the ash is able to wash away a lot easier than that harder volcanic rock. Moving forward, here's just an example of biological. Here is a tree stuck between a hard place It was a joke. It was a joke. And then we have this here. This gal here is standing next to this huge pile of debris. That's actually soil that's been relocated by ants. So that is an actual ant hill. But the ant colony is not just above, but is also below. So they took all that material and built this out between a mixture of their saliva and the grains themselves. It feels like it's concrete. It's a very solid mass. But these are very prominent in Africa. So let's try a couple examples. Here's a photo. Is this mechanical or chemical or both? So if you guess that part of it was chemical because of the red oxides, you'd be correct. If you're seeing this large piece of rock looks like it must have fallen from somewhere, that must have been some process of mechanical, then you're also correct. Here's another one. Mechanical or chemical? Well, in this process, we can see that this was a rock slide here. Essentially, this material was once here. The ocean crashes against that, making it weak underneath, so this would be part of a mechanical or physical process. And here's one more. Mechanical or chemical, or both. Well, this one here is definitely looking more at the mechanical process. We can see there's been abrasion. This has been sandblasted. This is actually a feature found in Death Valley. This archway is a little bit unique. This is over an Arches National Monument. This is a mixture of mechanical and chemical. So we can see this is red, so there must have been some oxides that have rusted. But this hole that's been carved in between is definitely part of a process of mechanical erosion. So, what does that mean? Well, there are some great videos that are online. I always suggest there's a free video. It's through Bill Nye the Science Guy, and it's called Weathering and Erosion. If you want to see a little bit more about that, I highly, highly suggest it. I think it's a great video to watch. So let's talk about just a few more things, and then we'll wrap up. This is a really complex diagram, but I just throw it in here because I want to talk about it real briefly. So Bowen was a scientist that put pretty much common sense into a graph, saying that, you know, I get it. There must be certain types of minerals that are more susceptible to weathering and some that are not, that are more resilient and able to withstand. So looking at these three minerals down here, which formed in lower temperatures and were the last to weather, these cooled, in this particular case, perhaps the slowest. We have potassium, feldspar, muscovite, mica, and quartz. These are the last to crystallize. This is pretty much your recipe for most household granite. Everything on this side over here, sodium-rich and calcium-rich feldspars, these are more susceptible to weathering. So I'm not asking you to memorize this diagram at all. I'm asking you to understand that there is a what we call the Bowens reaction series that just does put things in an order, understanding that there are some minerals are more susceptible to weathering than others. And again, that brings you back to when we talk about this diagram here. These are obviously, whatever makes up this rock is much more susceptible, is much more resilient than this material down here. Moving forward, so what is erosion? Well, again, erosion is the actual think motion. Here's a photo of it's called Zabriskie Point in Death Valley. This is called the Badlands, meaning that this land is bad. Nothing grows there. But look at how rich these little canyons are that have been carved out from water. This material is very soft. So we have, obviously, mechanical processes involved, but it's also the process of water is removing it. And that's that idea of erosion. Now, as this material moves away, it has to go somewhere. And that's where we bring in the values of stratigraphy. So names aren't important in this sequence, but these two individuals, Nicholas Steno and also looking at William Smith, they're the ones who went back and said, you know what, there must be a law of superposition, meaning the order in which things are deposited. So we can understand that when looking at weathering and erosion is that this is a screenshot of Avenue S there on in the Palmdale-Lancaster area just before the San Andreas Fault Zone. We can see that these rocks are bent and folded and moved around. You can really see it right here. In fact, this is what we did acknowledge as a syncline. Well, we know that because of the laws of superposition that this material would have been deposited in a sequence of lateral sequence, so even more horizontal in that sense. So in this case, we can see that there's been some form of compression that forced these rocks to create this shape. Well, then fast forward almost 100 years, William Smith is what we identify as the father of stratigraphy, being the first to actually make a geologic map. And so we did this activity in our lab class, perhaps, that we looked at how do we put this back in order? How do we take this rock diagram, separate it, pull it apart, and make it all horizontal so we understand the order in which things had been laid? So that brings us to the last slide, which is the principles of lateral continuity. The principles of lateral continuity just means that everything at this way was all conformed, nice and layered, made sense, undeformed, great. But because of change, these layers can often be skewed, or they can be offset, or they can be a little more complicated to understand. So the job of the structural geologist is to take this vision and find a way to turn it back into this so we can understand the process. So it says at the time of deposition, sedimentary layers are continuous for very long distances. If they terminate abruptly, then they have undergone deformation or they have been eroded. The problem with deformation and erosion, specifically erosion, is that actually information gets lost. Look at this here. See how thick this yellow layer is? See how little it is down there? All that history has been removed. So when looking at perhaps the geologic timescale or geologic history, we lose that information. The two most common causes of abrupt bed termination are faulting, and what we identify is unconformities. We'll learn a little bit later in the text about unconformities. There are three in particular, so make sure that you're familiar with those very briefly. And then lastly, sedimentary layers can taper laterally into other units, meaning that at some point, this material will erode and perhaps move on top of here, and then, again, even more complicate the situation at hand. Well, thank you for joining me for this lecture. Again, there's additional videos and features that are found within the modules of the Canvas shell. And until then, we'll talk soon.